Good afternoon. Thank you for coming out this afternoon in support of the Art Cart Honoring the Legacy exhibition and Speaking the Legacy panel discussion. I am Sandra Edmonds Crewe, the Dean of the Howard University School of Social Work. I have a degree in social work. So this is the DC iteration of the Art Cart Saving and Legacy Program that took place during the 2015-16 academic year at four local institutions: American University, George Mason University, George Washington University, and Howard University. Co-moderating the panel with me this afternoon is Graduate Art Fellow Ajua Barrows, recent graduate of the Corcoran School of Art and Design at George Washington University. This fall, an exhibition of nine New York Art Cart participating artists will be on display at the New York University's Kimmel Center, Stovall Gallery in New York City. Art Cart is an intergenerational arts legacy demonstration program developed by Joan Jeffrey, founder of the Research Center of Arts and Culture at Columbia University. It brings together aging professional artists with graduate students in the disciplines of art education, arts administration, fine arts, oral history, social work, public health, and occupational therapy. Its primary mission is to involve graduate students in an intergenerational experience that assists older artists in the documentation of their artistic and cultural legacy, as well as studio organization and preservation of their life's work. Participating artists become knowledgeable about digitally documenting their art and maintaining a safe and healthy studio environment for continued practice. Participating graduate students in the arts shared their artworks and art process with professional artists, received valuable critical feedback, and began thinking about plans to document their own artistic legacy as it unfolds. All participants were provided with opportunities to further develop as skilled practitioners in their various fields. I had the pleasure of being a part of this process during the last academic year.
Okay, I'd like to just thank everybody for showing up for this event. We really appreciate it. The RCAC, which is the Research Center of Arts and Culture at Columbia University, would like to thank the National Endowment for the Arts, Pollock Krasner Foundation, the Joan Mitchell Foundation, the Agua Fund, Golden Artist Colors, Blick Art Materials, and the Wu Zorin International Foundation of Fine Arts for their support of the Art Cart Saving the Legacy program. Okay, so what we'll do today, we will be asking questions of the two artists on our panel, and we'd like to thank Chioni Fragioni and EJ Evangeline Montgomery for participating in this event. The theme for this year's discussion is turning points. So the way we will conduct the panel, Dr. Crewe and I will be answering questions to the two of you, and you can answer as desired. The very first question is, describe a particular moment in your life that made a substantial impact on your art. Can you speak about a seminal turning point in your artistic development that validated your choice to be an artist? And either one of you can start.
Somebody else start. Okay. She wants you to start. She wants me to start. Okay. How far back do we have to go? They are.
Well, there's a light on.
Okay. Is that better?
No.
No? Okay. Is that better?
I got a loud voice. I could just.
All right. Can you hear that? Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. Is it on?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I would say the first turning point I had was actually when I was
16. It was the first time I went to Italy. And my background is in dance. So I was standing in front of David, and I realized how I could take sculpture or the plastics and use the same energy that I had and the same muscle memory in painting and in the sculpture world. And it allowed me so much freedom that it just stopped me in my tracks. And so it was, for me, a changing point of not only being a dancer, but also learning that I could go into the visual arts as well. And when I finally retired as a dancer, I was able just to move into that process. So it is something I've never forgotten, and I can just stand there and have that memory be as vivid as it was when I was there in Rome.
Okay, EJ, would you like to comment on a particular moment in your life that made a substantial impact on your art? And you can speak about a seminal turning point in your artistic development that validated your choice to be an artist.
Well, I've lived in a number of cities, and at age 14, I was in New York City, and there was a terrible snowstorm, and I spent the several days at home just painting. I had received a painting set. Not exactly paint by numbers, but almost that type of thing. And I decided during that time of painting several days that I could probably be an artist. I was pleased with the work that I had created and was eager to go further in studying art. I went to a high school that had offered several art classes, so I took most of those classes, and there were different techniques and whatnot, and I didn't make up my mind just what I was interested in specializing in at that time. It wasn't until years later that came, but I knew that I wanted to be an artist. Okay.
Thank you, EJ. Another question, what do you see as the biggest challenge in having a lifetime as an artist, and how have you dealt with that in your creative career?
The biggest challenge, I think, well, there's several. Or at least for right now, is the time, is making sure you always have time. And I'm a very disciplined woman, and learning that discipline by taking away excess things in my life, in the sense of I'm always saying, okay, I'm in the studio first, and then I will have to weigh whether I go out and visit a friend, or I weigh whether I need to be doing this, or I weigh need to do that. And so sometimes it is frustrating, especially if you're also working, I'm also a teacher. So sometimes that gets a little frustrating. However, that challenge of the time is not only just day to day, but the time of your lifespan. The older I get, the more that I want to do, and there's more things that I really want to get to, and so time becomes more and more precious. it also allows you to, sort of do what you need to do, and it sort of allows you to say, well, the heck with this, I can just do what I sort of want in the art world, in the sense of work, and it's very freeing, but I certainly want to have that time to really do the things that are really deep inside me that I want to come out and explore and find out, like, what I'm really made out of or what I can really do in that world in front of the canvas or making assemblages. So that's probably the challenge is making sure you have all that time.
Thank you. What about you, EJ? What do you see as some of the biggest challenges in having a lifetime as an artist? And how have you dealt with that in your creative career?
Well, I think the biggest challenge for me has been just securing space to work in and to be able to do the whatever type of art I feel like doing at that particular time. And I have worked in a number of different media. So each calls for a separate kind of space, ceramics or metal or printmaking, weaving, various areas of the arts like that. And then I've also been concerned with how other people are working and how I can help them to progress in their field, in their interests, in creating exhibitions and programs like this for other artists.
Thank you, EJ.
Okay. Thank you so much for your feedback and comments. I think they've been extremely enlightening. I'd like to now go more into talking about the aging process. How has the process of aging affected your artistic ideas and practice?
Well, I would say we're getting mature.
I was expecting that comment.
It's experience. Uh-huh. Life gives you experience, and that you take that experience and you keep developing it and putting it into your work, and that in turn keeps growing and changing and shifting. When you get out of school, you have this energy and you have this, you're young and you're just jumping into everything. But the beauty is that as you get more mature with your work, and have that experience with your work has these levels and layers that are really can speak to the audience at different points of views of their life, or they can speak at different levels. It's not a quick fix. It's not like something you see instantly. You can go back to the work and keep looking at it, and it will tell you something, or you might find something that it speaks to you. I think the greatest thing about maturing is that when you're making art and you hang it on the wall or you put it on this pedestal, it allows people to stand in front of it and dream. And they can dream some of your dreams, but they start to dream their own. And depending on how their experience is in life, no matter what that age is, you're hoping that you can touch them on some level. You could hope you can speak to them on some level. And as you keep growing as an artist, one hopes that, it gets better and more seasoned. So I'm not so fond about this aging name, but, I would say maturing is even greater.
Thank you. That was very insightful. And again, I'm a gerontologist, so I'm always prepared for the pushback on the aging. So I am absolutely comfortable with your characterization of maturing. So EJ, same question. How has the process of maturing affected your artistic ideas and practice?
I'm not sure how to answer that. I don't know. Let me wait a while.
Okay. Absolutely. So let me go on to the next question. And that is, how do you deal with the everyday important necessities of things like health insurance, pension savings, choices to raise a family or not? So how do all those things figure into your artistic work?
Well, I was really young when I started a family. And I was living in the Bay Area, and you know, when I was a young woman artist, the men were really supportive, maybe a little bit more than actually some of the women, because they saw the seriousness in the work that I was doing. But there was this fine line in the art world. Well, if you were a mom, you weren't really a serious artist. And if you were a woman, well, you weren't really all that serious either. And, you know, it was a struggle. It really was a struggle. I did all kinds of works. I was a diver's tender. I could weld, and so they wanted me to become an underwater, do underwater constructing and weld, which, you know, I didn't want to do that. But I was, you know, I was the tender, and so I was able to, I harnessed all the men up and I threw them off the boat while they were welding, and, you know, got to lift 200-pound type of weights, you know, kept me in good shape. I taught. I, you know, worked in and ran a prison project program, and finally was worked for the state of California, so you had insurance. But after 8 years, that was like really stressful, and so I'm not afraid to like making those changes. I couldn't. I have two daughters, and they're in their 30s and 40s. It's not easy to raise children, you know, mm-hmm. as an artist, and especially being a single mom, it was even mm-hmm. harder. But if this is what you love to do, you do it, and you find the ways of doing it. And I lived in this, it was in Oakland, it was on Fifth Avenue, and it was the oldest artist's colony, and the man who owned it, you know, normally, children weren't allowed to live in this place because it was an illegal live-in. And he just said, well, your children are always visiting. And I had to think about this, you know, like, what do you mean? Because it was illegal and we had to, you know. So whenever anybody showed up, they're just visiting. Mm-hmm. You know, I talked to my kids. And it was a life, and it was a good life, and they balanced with it. It's not easy, but you can do it, okay? But any life is hard, you know. And insurance, well, that's a scary thing. Paychecks, that's also a scary thing. You know, you have to do the jobs that you have to do, which is what I was saying about time. It's sometimes frustrating. But again, you go back to, this is the life. This is what I've chosen to do. And you just have to learn to make it work. And that's what I've done.
Thank you. So it sounds like risk-taking is a part of the portfolio of being an artist. Absolutely. Same question, EJ. How do you deal with the everyday important necessities of things like health insurance, pension savings, choices to raise or not raise a family? How does that affect your daily activities of life?
Well, the insurance, once I moved to Washington and started working in a permanent kind of position with the government, I was able to, okay. Once I moved to Washington and received a job with the government, I was able to think more about things like insurance and whatnot, and make plans for myself, you know, in that there was a retirement built in and things of that nature, which I hadn't thought about until, mm-hmm. you know, half of my life, really. As far as savings and whatnot, I think as a lot of artists are kind of wild when they're they're more concerned with creating and putting their monies back into that than thinking about your later years and whatnot. But I would advise and do advise younger artists to consider all of these things like that. And start planning early in life. I was lucky in that I had not been ill up until near my retirement days. But I see now what, you know, problems can arise and how the illnesses can just take over everything, your thoughts and your plans for your art and your life in general.
And thank you so much. I think that, you know, the point of if you're an artist, you're reinvesting in your craft rather than saving. And that is really a point that's really important as we began to kind of think about this whole area. Another question is there was a healthy aging component to this project, and fellows from public health, social work, and related fields sometimes spoke with you about making your studios a safer and more productive environment. I'm sure you remember that assessment, correct? Did any of you have experiences that helped you to do that? Did you do anything to make your environment safer and during this whole process?
Because of the various disciplines that I've worked in, I've been concerned with the environment process all along with my work. And as I've aged and whatnot, I had to work in other people's studios. So I find myself talking to them about the environmental problems in the studio. And almost any material that you choose to work with, there's a problem that could happen and affect your whole life.
Well, I've been in my studio for 15 years. It's very, well, it's actually improved, but it's very funky, and it's very, it's a good-sized studio. However, I would say the biggest thing about it is it's cold. The heat is very poor system, and sometimes I feel like at my age I shouldn't have to be worrying about, like, you know, 700 layers and freezing in there. You know, I take concerned about, I make my own paints, so I'm concerned about, you know, inhaling pigments, but, you know, and I go to the doctor and get checked out, but, and I find I have more things that are on wheels because it's easier to push instead of me hauling things. So I'm just practical, you know, I'm practical about what I can do and what I can't do. Though I have to remind myself of my age, because sometimes I forget that, and I come from a family that is, you know, very active. I mean, my dad's 95 and my parents still go out dancing. So I have a feeling that, you know, I'm sort of that active type of person, and when you think younger than what you are, you probably behave that way. But to be wise, I mean, wise about if you're using toxic materials, don't be foolish. You know, I teach, and I teach students, and though I'm not teaching them how to make their paints, I teach them to respect the materials, that these materials can be harmful, and you have to use them wisely. So, you know, when the fellows came and looked at my studio, it's pretty fine. The landlord is not generous, but he's, you know, to be honest with you, in D.C., you have to really pick your battles about what you're doing, you know, because the studio systems are here. They're short, and they're hard to get a hold of. So you sort of make do with things that you have, you know.
Thank you. Thank you guys both for your insight in this area. A couple more questions. How much does your workspace dictate the kind, size, or medium in which you work and have worked?
Well, the size of the workspace?
How much does the workplace, you know, the physical layout maybe of your workspace dictate the kind, the size, and types of materials, you know, you'll be working with?
Well, I guess it does have some effect on your selection of materials, but I've tried to find spaces to work in that suit whatever it is I want to do at the time, you know. I've done metalsmithing, as you know, and unfortunately I haven't been able to work as I would like to work in that area. And now with my illness, I've pretty much given that up because I don't have steadiness in my hands and whatnot. But I'm thinking of something else, I guess, now.
Okay. Thank you, EJ. What about you?
Well, I've worked in a lot of different spaces, and space is important to me. It sort of sometimes it does dictate, I think it does dictate what you do. When I travel, I work small, you know, I don't worry about paints and you know, working from a suitcase. And when I, my studio is about 750 square feet. It's long and linear, and I seem to always gravitate towards these long and linear type of spaces. It's got great light. When I first came here, I took a studio in the building I'm in just to get in, and it was like 300 square feet, no windows, I was dying in there. You know, it was just because, you know, there was no light or air. So the space I have now, the lighting is really beautiful. So that's really important to me. My work ranges from like 5 inches to 7 inches, you know, drawings to, you know, long, big paintings that, you know, can extend so I can have the length. The funny thing is, the other thing that's important to me is my car, because when I was traveling and when I was living in California, I had to make sure, because I didn't have access to a truck, so I made sure all the work fit through the hole, so the paintings became like 60 by 30, and I just, all my work ranged in that scale because I could get it in the car, and I never had to, you know, rent a truck because that was more money. So those are the practical things I think we think about. But the obviously the bigger the space, the more you can do, the larger you can do things in. But on the average, you know, my space that I have is good. And it's sort of gritty, so I can be messy, which I like to do, and then, you know, be nice to have one clean area, but, you know, I do like that.
Okay. Thank you for sharing. Let's just change the topic a little bit. We're going to deal with documentation because, as you know, a large part of the project dealt with the documentation of works. That was kind of the focus. Why is it important, do you think, for younger artists to start thinking about documentation of their work?
I think it's very important that they think about the documentation right from the very beginning, as well as their selection of materials to work with. I've tried to encourage young people to use the best materials that they can, because they never know when they are actually going to create that showpiece. And For instance, you know, are you going to work in gold? Or are you going to work in silver or brass or what? And what would give you the best design? And whatnot in the way of materials. I also think it's important to, well, to just record everything as you make it, write up the process, keep some records, journals of what you're doing. For instance, if you're going to sell the work, eventually people want to know how it was created. And if you're going to show it or give it to a museum or something like that, you've got to give them all the details about the pieces. So I think that is very important that an artist keep records.
Thank you, EJ, for that insight. And Gianni?
I agree. Mm-hmm. Documentation is important. I mean, I've been pretty good about that all my life. You know, if you're not a good photographer, hire a good one. You know, which I do, because I'm not good at the documentation of photography. And no matter how much I've tried to teach myself, I don't have the patience. So I spend the money to do that. It's almost like I think about, okay, framing is important. Then I hire someone to do that because I don't do it well. So it's learning to know what you do well and what you don't do. I've always kept records of the photography. I made up my own system, which was pretty, you know, like filings, and put all the images in there through bodies of work. You know, I've kept boxes because I have a tendency to like boxes. So I store the boxes. Like when I worked at the prison project, all the things that I did with that is in this box. When I would do a body of work, I would call the name of the box and I'd throw things in there. So I'm good about that. It's important. You know, I read things. You know, when I read Van Gogh's letters, I mean, he was a man who wrote all the time. And when you read things like this from artists, it gives you insight. You feel like you're not alone. It also gives you insight to maybe different ways of the thinking. It's just another avenue, and for maybe younger artists, it's important. It's important to share that. I mean, I do believe that artists, part of our responsibility is to share what we know, you know, not to keep it a secret. Most of them. So that documentation is important, whether it's through the slides and through the accurate records, and when you do donate and when you do certain things or selling, it's good just to have that. And I mean, I will find this system, Embark, was a little challenging, but it's just nice to know that it's all going to be like in one place. And that's important. It makes it easy. It makes it easy for the people, once you're gone, it makes it easy for the people to take over. You certainly don't want to leave them too much of a mess.
Thank you, Gianni and EJ. Part of what you're sharing with us are lessons of life, you know, knowing what you do well and knowing what you don't do well, really important. Thank you for sharing that. I'd like you to now speak about the intergenerational, interdisciplinary relationships between you, your working partner, and your student fellows in ArtCart.
I felt that I had a very good relationship with the fellows with both people, and that we were able to share a lot of information and experiences, and I think there were things that we talked about that might serve as future projects for them and things that they may wish to work on in the future that they may or may not have considered before meeting me. But I think that they had varied experiences as well as I, and we really complemented each other.
I just wanted to speak on that for a second. EJ happened to be my artist. I was the graduate fellow in our team, and we had Claude Elliott was our working partner. And it was an amazing experience because I knew of EJ from my past. I think I was a high school student when I first met her in Chicago, and she was affiliated with an organization that I belonged to also, the National Conference of Artists. So to have had the opportunity to connect with her again on a different level was amazing. And when Pamela, Dr. Lawton, suggested that I work with her, I was really excited and jumped right on the opportunity. So, you know, being able to have that one-on-one experience with EJ, to be able to learn more about her work, to do more research on her work, and the opportunity of having that experience of doing the oral history project, all those things were critical and wonderful for me. So it was an amazing experience.
My fellow and my working partner, Natalie and Elizabeth, they were wonderful. It was a really nice experience. We sort of chuckled because when I first met Elizabeth, she said, well, I'm very laid back. And I said, well, I'm not. And we were sort of nervous about like, uh-oh. But it was a nice balance. It was really, you know, it was sweet hearing her points of views, her thoughts, her insights, and it was a nice mutual exchange. We worked really well together, and she worked also really well with Natalie. Natalie, who's my working partner, I was her former teacher. So I had her in high school. And when Pam came, we were talking about this, and Natalie says, well, she's known me since I was 13, and I almost fell off my chair because I forgot that she was, you know, I teach students as freshmen that are that young. And she's now in her mid-20s, and we've had this ongoing relationship in which I've watched her grow as an artist, as, you know, she loves doing behind the scenes. She's actually talked more and more about doing research. She's a young woman that is smart and curious and loves to work. And we've gotten along, and we've just shared this bond since she was like in school. So it's nice to see this transition of somebody that I was teaching, and now we're moving into another level of our relationship. I think you have to trust somebody to have them help you do this, you know? I mean, our work is important to us, and it's like, it's our lives, and so it's nice to have somebody that you can, you know that they're helping you get to save it for the future.
Thank you so much. I had the opportunity of working with our student, Chanel Kitt, who worked with Mr. Alonzo Davis. And Mr. Davis became a part of our classroom because Chanel was always talking about the amazing Alonzo Davis. So she talked about him so much, she insisted that I go to his studio. And I said, now, I'm the dean. I don't have time. She said, but you must go to his studio. So when I went to his studio, he talked about the value of this whole opportunity to work with a social work student who also is an aspiring artist. So the intergenerational aspects are truly beneficial. And I would say that the students receive much more than they gave through this experience. So thank you for supporting their learning experiences. So in closing, is there anything else that you would like to add or say about your experience with ArtCart?
Well, it was wonderful to have the experience. I worked with a number of groups and projects over the years, but it was nice to have someone to sit with me and concentrate on my work. Interesting enough, just someone is writing a book, and just a couple of weeks ago, they sent me parts of a chapter where they included quite a bit of my early experiences in the field. And it's interesting to note that, you know, we were talking and doing some of the same things that somebody is actually putting in a book about my experiences. And they've also included other artists that were in school with me. And it's really quite interesting to see the development like that. I've had quite a bit of contact with artists all over the United States and artists who are working in various media, and as well as museum people. So I've had a chance to look at a number of ways in which artists experience their life. And art, the creativity that they have now, and the new technology, which I think this offered, this art cop offered me an opportunity to be involved and to think about the new technology in the field. And I've tried to concentrate on printmaking, because that's something that I could do more easily than the other things, and I can work by myself and I can work with others in the various techniques involved in printmaking. But to be able to look at the computer, what it offers, and other equipment like that, has been very exciting. And to meet young people that knew a lot more about it than I did, really helps teach me the hands-on.
Well, I would say the balance between what we know and what they know is nice, you know. Because sometimes our embark was batty, and Natty was able to solve it. And it's also, it was nice to have, you know, I put in about 400 entries, and, you know, then we went back, and we were doing all the dotting the I's and crossing the T's, and it was sort of nice to, I have to say, it was really nice to have her have to do that and not me, because I could do other things. And then she would, you know, call me over and say, I have a question about this, and then we'd start talking maybe about the piece. It's just a nice combination that, what I hope is that, you know, it's like with all the new technology that's happening, that there's still the cube, there's still people who do things with your hands, and not to throw all that away, because if we do, you know, it'll come back, but it'll come back a little watered down. And I like learning new things, and so they help me grow in technology as well. Gets me thinking in other ways.
Okay, and well, Embark, just as a point of clarification, was a digital tool that we used to document the work, because the largest part of the whole project was the documentation of artists' work. Okay, well, I just wanted to thank everybody, EJ, Chioni, Dr. Crew, for participating in the panel discussion. And I would just like to encourage everybody, if you haven't had a chance, to browse the exhibition. It'll be up through August, but it's a great time right now. Thank you.